meeting is also, I'm going to tell you folks right up front, and I say this in all kindness, the door is right there, and I'm saying that for a reason, and I mean this in all in kindness. After the things I've studied for 20-some years, I've been involved in this kind of thing for 20-some years, I have watched our country eroded, totally eroded of all justice and decency in some cases. I mean, if you've been looking at the Spokane paper lately, see what's going on in some of the areas down there, I mean, and around some of our cities in the country, the depravity that's covering our land today is disgusting. There were many battles over the last years that were fought, abortion and things like that, and all I can say in all true honesty, we lost. We lost the battle. Let's be honest with ourselves. We lost. Why did we lose? Well, you're going to find out today why we lost. And I'm saying this in all honesty. I'm going to be very adamant today. I'm not going to argue about anything. I'm going to stand on the truth. I'm going to stand on facts. You have to realize, in all due respect to our elected servants, and we have some here today, and I really appreciate you fellows for coming. Our sheriff and the county commissioner, thank you for coming this morning. And by the way, you're always welcome at our meetings. Just know that. You're always welcome. So these meetings are open to anyone. But these things, simple truths, such simple truths to some of us have become so complex today in our political system. And it's a shame. But I'm going to be very adamant about what I talk about today. And this comes from years and years of study of law. And I get in arguments with elected servants all the time about that. I'm very serious. I'm not going to pull any punches. If you are of a politically correct mindset, you're probably not going to be very comfortable. And I'm sorry, and I'm not sorry really, but you know, I've got to do what needs to be done. Things in our country are degrading. There's a lot of our elected and many of our average people out here are denying it. They're just trying to ignore it. I got an email yesterday from a concerned individual that, and this is just an example, that the bill that went through Congress that allows the Department of Homeland Security to take authority of the 100-mile zone didn't pass. Well, you know, that's exactly the kind of rhetoric and the kind of political nonsense that they put out, because what they don't realize is the Department of Homeland Security is a non-constitutional agency from the beginning. They don't answer to Congress, which is the problem. That's one of the problems. They don't answer to Congress, and that is a fact. That's a fact. They don't answer to them. So that's something you have to keep in mind. Now, our reason for gathering today, we make no mistake, we are here today because our economic, political, and governmental representative systems have failed to act in accordance with the fundamental laws of our nation. We got to get to the point of understanding that. We got to understand that. Our constitutional protections have been ignored by our elected body in general. There are some who have tried to uphold them, but they don't have any power against the scourge of other elected who do not know the law and don't uphold it. I hear this all the time. Well, the conservatives in the legislature are trying to do this, that, or the other, but the liberals in there run the legislature and they can't do it. That's no excuse. That's no excuse. When you're in a meeting, if you're used to conducting official meetings, and there's a thing called point of order. When someone is out of order, someone is supposed to stand up and say, point of order, you're out of order. If you're discussing a matter that the legislature has no subject matter jurisdiction over in the first place, someone is supposed to call them on it. We had a couple commissioners years ago that did that. They would go to Olympia and in these meetings, and they would actually stand up and say, point of order, you can't even discuss that. You know, and that's what's happened. We don't have those people that stand up and do that. That's very, very important to understand. All of our legislatures, whether it's Congress or the state legislature, have subject matter jurisdictions they can handle and things they cannot handle. It's all about delegated authority. And through that convoluted system, things get passed into RCWs that people try to call law when the Supreme Court's already ruled that all laws that are repugnant to the Constitution are not law. They're null and void from their inception. But how often does the legislature go back to the state constitution and the United States Constitution to make sure that what they're doing is within their delegated authority to do it? They don't. In that respect, they have failed the people. But our legislatures across the land continually write bills. And that's what people are hanging on. I hear it all the time. Well, the gun issue, the gun rights issue, Second Amendment issue. Well, they're going to pass some legislation that protects it. We already have legislation that protects it. It's called the Second Amendment. It's the supreme law of the land. You can't get around it. There's no way you can get around it. But we got to write some more legislation. Why? Because we have to justify our existence. That's what the legislature is doing. They're justifying their existence. They got to do something to get paid. And in some cases, our local leaders stand helpless and are delinquent and careless in their duty to intervene on our behalf because they don't know what to do. I'm not saying they're all malicious at all, but sometimes they don't know what to do because they didn't study the law. And there's a Supreme Court case I like to go back to all the time that says all public servants are assumed to presume to know the law. You know, well, that's a big assumption today because they don't. By and large, they don't. But make no mistake, I have no grand delusions that we're going to save our nation or state from the subversions they have already embedded themselves into. The subversions have already embedded themselves into our social and political apparatus. The treason is too deep and the ignorance is too deep at this point. It's way too deeply embedded now. Especially the ignorance. The ignorance, as I've said in many of my letters I've written, the ignorance is the greatest weapon in the world. It is the greatest weapon on earth. Nuclear weapons pale in comparison to ignorance. Ignorance is huge. So we are here, in my humble opinion, to grasp a hold of our local situation and provide a means of securing our liberties and our freedoms within our county jurisdiction with the hope that our other counties will follow. That's the goal of the Stevens County Assembly from the very beginning. Now, we do have some good elected folks from time to time. I think we've got a couple now. But, you know, when you don't have public support, when you don't have people involved, there's only so much they can really do. Now, again, I'm not here to pull any punches today. I will say that's no excuse because I have known elected servants in the past who did what was right anyway. It cost them. It cost them. But I want to make something else clear. When you're elected servant, you are no different than a man that takes an oath and joins the Marines or the Army or the Air Force or anything else. You're no different. If you have to kill yourself to do what's right, that's what you do. That's how it is, folks. When you take an oath, it doesn't matter what you have to do to make things right or to set things straight. It doesn't matter how much ridicule, how politically incorrect you have to be to stand up for what's right. You just do it. When I took that oath in the Marines and we went out to the battlefield, I never questioned my duty. I never questioned what I had to do. We were given orders that I thought was just absolutely stupid. And sometimes they were, actually. Stupid. But you know what? That doesn't matter. I took an oath to obey all those orders, and I obeyed them, and we carried it out, good or bad. But it's no different being a public servant. And the people of our counties need to make that clear to their elected. It doesn't matter what the Republican Party says. It doesn't matter what the Democratic Party says. They're not in authority. They don't have any delegated authority in our constitutions. They are a zero when it comes to running government. They don't have any authority. The unions have no authority in law. None. And we've just got to stand on it. We've got to learn to not take no for an answer. These people have no authority in law. I know many of you are here to discuss the 100-mile security zone, but this is all leading up to that. Our local government cannot plead ignorance, nor can they blame the state for their misguided acts and behavior. And I wonder how many of them have ever looked up the word state in the Black's Law Dictionary. You ought to try looking up the word. It'll change your whole opinion on the way government works. A state is a people working through their elected government. That's what it is. It's not a government telling people what to do. They don't tell us what to do. We tell them what to do. And that's part of the problem today. Now, obviously we have a law and we have to work within that law. We can't just start making demands not based on some foundation of law, obviously. God in His wisdom gave us law to protect and guide our future, and we have failed to enforce that law upon our local elected in behalf of our communities. And that goes for the whole country. We have absolutely failed as a people to uphold our law. We have. So in beginning here, we're going to go a few minutes here through some preliminary things, and then we'll take a quick break so people can take care of business, get some more coffee, and whatever you might need to stay awake. But anyway, so we'll go through a few reports here. But one of the things I was talking to one of the commissioners earlier this week was the state mandates. We were discussing state mandates. And this is one of the things that plague commissioners the most and make their life very difficult is state mandates. And the very term state mandates rubs me the wrong way in the first place. The state cannot mandate anything that it does not have the authority in law to mandate. That's simple. But that's the problem with it. It's too simple today. Do you think the convolution of things today is an accident? No, it's not an accident. They convolute things to keep people, the average people, from being able to work in their government today, to be able to control the instruments they have created, which every individual in the United States of America has a right to control the instrument they created. It's even in one of our RCWs in the Public Records Act. It's in the 42 section. The people have the right to control the instruments they've created. That's our law, that's our elected. They are our instruments. They are fiduciary servants. We are the principal. That's a matter of law. We have unions that they say that our county commissioners have to arbitrate with. Well, my uncle was a sheriff in West Virginia for 22 years. When the state came down in West Virginia and said, you have to arbitrate with the unions over the deputy salaries, whether you can afford it or not, you have to arbitrate with them. He said, no, I don't. He showed the union the back door of the county. And that's what happened about 20 years there. It took about 2 years to get that done. But I make no illusions here. Nothing happens that quick and that simple. But for about 20 years, they had no union there. And as soon as he got out of office for health reasons, the next sheriff that came in brought the union right back in with them. And things got real expensive again. And I'm certainly not against our sheriff's department, our deputies. We need good deputies. We need a good sheriff's department. But, you know, in this complex society today, everything's been made very complex. Just because we have great technology today doesn't mean our law and the way we operate in government has to be complex. Somehow people think it has to be so complex today. It doesn't. The law is very simple. The law is very forward. It means what it says. And it needs to be followed. And it's all about delegated authorities in the end. It all comes down to delegated authorities. The whole entire republic law system in the United States of America is based on delegated authority. Everything is. But that's never going to happen until the people stand on it. Then we have our property tax issue. Commissioner was sharing with me that people are coming to the Board of Equalization. They're getting their adjustments, and it goes right back to the assessor again, and he jacks it right back up again. So what's the point of going to the Board of Equalization if that's going to happen? The whole problem is they reconstructed the way they handle the property taxes now. I'm not going to get into this too deep, but they reconstructed it. And the first question I would have asked was, show me the authority in the law that you have to reconstruct the way property taxes are handled. They can't find it because it's not there. So we got a real problem there. Then we got things like our state can do nothing more than find ways to add more burdens to us. They want to add more taxes to our gas now, as if things aren't bad enough. Who's representing who here? We're not being represented. Now, we have another problem that is part of the 100-mile security zone that really plays into it later. It may not play into it so much now, but it does open the door for some things. And at first, when I first thought about talking about this, I was thinking about being a little ginger about it. But, you know, we can't be ginger about it. We have a cattlemen's association in our county, which has probably the biggest lobby in the county. They deal with the feds because of the land issues, and the sheriff's helped them out with that some. He has. But they deal with these feds on these land issues and cattle issues, the wolf issues, dealing with the state on that. And they sit down in these negotiations, and it just irritates me to no end, because you can't negotiate something you already have the right to do. The state comes in and creates a problem, then we get saddled with the problem. And then they want to find a way to pay to fix the problem. That's insanity. They should all be in jail. Every one of them that had anything to do with that. They create a problem, and then we're stuck with the problem. Then our cattlemen got to take the time to negotiate it. But our cattlemen's association, in their negotiations, they never use law. They never use law and find out what kind of delegated authorities these agencies have that they're talking to. You can't sit down at the table with the government if you don't know the rules of engagement. And nobody's using the rule book. They pull out the RCWs and things like that. That's not the rule book. Some of the RCWs do line up with the state constitution, but some of them don't. And you got to know the difference. You got to be able to sit down and know the difference. You can't just take it at face value and sit down and start throwing that out there. It doesn't work. And then some of these agencies are federal agencies from time to time, and they have no jurisdiction in our county unless the state has ceded a piece of property to them, or there's a contract between the state and the federal government on that land. But then you got to pull the contract and find out what the contract says, what kind of agreements were made. A lot of times it's just a management contract, but it doesn't prohibit cattlemen from running their cattle on the ranges or the forest grass or whatever. It doesn't. But my point here is, what the Cattlemen's Association may not realize is that every time they sit down at the table with these people and every time they make some kind of agreements with these people, they affect everybody in the county, not just them. It affects everyone. Because you know what's happening here. These encroachments by the federal government especially, every time you weaken that path, they get stronger and stronger on the other side. And they push harder and harder to get more control. And that's got to stop. And in fact, I would go so far to say, as our county commissioners, all of our elected people, if they're having meetings with the federal government, they should never be able to have a meeting with the federal government where the people can't be there to monitor what's going on. In fact, it really, when you get right down to it, in many cases, they don't have the delegated authority to even do that in the first place, because it's an out-of-jurisdiction agency. The federal government, clearly in the Constitution, it states where their jurisdictions are. Article 1, Section 8, Clause 17 gives you exactly what their jurisdiction is. And that's the only jurisdiction they have. And we'll get to that in more detail later. And then we have some other things going on at the state level. Bill 5625, which is basically a carbon copy of 1588, requiring universal background checks. We got that coming. Then we have Bill 1676, which adds more layers of bureaucracy unto existing laws, invoking reckless endangerment and proper storage of firearms. You know, I'm not against proper storage of firearms and people being responsible with firearms. Obviously not. But that's not a place for the government to get involved. The only way they can monitor that is to come into your house on your private property. So you see where that goes? You got to think ahead on these things. The only way that would work is if they could come and inspect your home. And that's exactly what they want to do. There's some bills around the country in different states where they're actually trying to do that, trying to make it legal for the police officers to come into your house and make inspections. And that may not happen, but that's something they're trying to do. You need to be aware of that. Then we have Bill 1703, which adds a tax onto the sale of firearms and ammunition to establish a state-provided firearm safety education. You know, that's just another burden they're placing on the citizens. Now, if any of you haven't noticed, try to go out and buy some ammo right now. My goodness gracious. If you don't have it now, you might be a little late. Might be a little too late. Because I don't think it's ever going to come back down again. I don't think you'll ever see it get cheaper again. Then we have a few other little things that are happening. And, of course, there's so many things happening, you can't hardly even keep up with it anymore. But constitutional attorney Michael Connolly has sent out several emails around the country outlining a plan by the Veterans Administration that basically, I want to keep this short, but creating a situation where the government gets to decide if veterans are competent to own firearms, basically is what they're trying to do. And they're basing it on Title 18, Code 924, Section 2. And I looked at that, and it's absolutely ludicrous. I mean, but again, that's out of jurisdiction. You can't apply that code to the county or the state jurisdiction without the consent of the state legislature and the people. You can't do that. So anyway, that's another idea they have, is to try to put that burden. And I'm not going to get into the China-America relationship too much. I study a lot of foreign policy and foreign intelligence reports. There are actually intelligence reports that are available in other countries that are actually public record. And you can find out what China's doing, what America's doing in relation to China, and those kind of relationships. But most of you might know this, but one of the reasons the Second Amendment is being attacked so hard is because the Chinese government wants to take possession of land in exchange for the $1 trillion deficit that we owe them, basically, the money that our nation, they say our nation owes them, our government owes them. They're the one that spent it. We didn't spend it. So they want to take possession of those lands, but they will not do it as long as Americans have all these guns. They don't feel secure because they live in a communist country where nobody has any guns except the military. So you can understand why they would feel that way. So they're pressuring the Obama administration greatly to put more restrictions and gather more of these weapons up. And so that's one of the reasons that's being pushed so hard. Now, we have a handout back there. I don't know how many people got it. Are you living in a constitution-free zone? Okay, some of you may already have that on your computer at home, may have already downloaded that information, but I'm not going to go read through this because you can read that for yourself. There are about 100 copies back there. Are there still copies back there? Yes, there are. Okay. Oh, and by the way, before I get too far along here, if you want to be on our email list to get our notices and information and things like that, there's a list back there for you to sign. And we'd be glad to send you our newsletters and things of that nature. And some of you may have already heard that we are preparing to do our own little newspaper. And it's going to be kind of a grassroots type newspaper. But we have people in Idaho, Montana, and all over the place wanting to write in it, and some people down in Spokane. And so we're going to pass it out far and wide as we can, and just to get good information out and use it as a tool to also teach people what they need to know about the law. You know, that's very important. Now, I want to say something, I want to preface this ACLU information with something, because when I called one of my friends and I said, well, the ACLU called me, I had one of their attorneys call me, we had a pretty long conversation, and, you know, the first thing I did, and I did this on the phone, I want you to know this as accountability for myself, but as soon as this attorney called me, I said, before we go any further, I want to make something real clear. I have never supported the ACLU. And the ACLU, I gave them a little bit of their own history. The ACLU was started by two communists many years ago. I said, you may not know that. He goes, I didn't know that. I said, I didn't think you did. But I said, I know that. I've studied the history. I know where you came from. But I want you to know, I agree with you on this subject matter. But beyond that, We have no relationships. I want to make that clear right up front. And he goes, that's good. You actually thank me for being honest with him. I wasn't going to sit there and pretend with him. So I want you to know that I would never support the ACLU. But you know, it's interesting that over the last 2 years, they have taken some really strong stands on some constitutional issues. And it's interesting to me that such a liberal organization would take such a stand like that when the average so-called Christian out here and people like that, people who are supposed to be real American patriots, have not. That's very interesting. But thank the Lord for small blessings, wherever you can get them from. You know, we take what we can get, don't we? So it's not often that I agree with them. And in closing on their fact sheet, they have a quote that I want to read you. This is their quote. This is basically their stand. And he sent me some more information that basically outlines this quote. And I quote, "If the current generation of Americans does not challenge this creeping and sometimes galloping expansion of federal powers over the individual through rationale of border protection, we are not doing our part to keep alive the rights and freedoms that we inherited, and we'll soon find that we have lost some or all of our right to go about our business and travel around inside their own country, for people to travel around inside their own country without interference from the authorities." And that's a statement from the ACLU. I have to tell you, knowing their history, I'm pretty impressed with that. That's a great statement. And their attorneys have offered to work with me and help in any way they can, any way that I'll let them work with me. You know, I tell you, I approach that exactly. I approach that very, very carefully. You know, so I hesitate to even let one of them stand up in one of our meetings and speak. I'm afraid I can't control what they're going to say. You know, but on this issue, they're pretty sharp. They have actually met with the Department of Homeland Security. Their top people have met with the Department of Homeland Security. So, and I say that because I want you to know something. When you get down to the local level of government and you start talking to your local leaders about this issue, I have to tell you that our local leaders are on a need-to-know basis. When it comes to this, I'm not picking on them. I'm just saying they're on a need-to-know basis. They probably have a lot less information on the 100-mile security zone than the average individual here wants to study. Not because they don't want to, because they don't have the time to. They're so busy working with everything else. So we got to help them. It's our land. It's our county. We got to step up to the plate and do our part. You know, we got to give them a hand with this. But some of you have got a map. You can kind of see the idea of the 100-mile security zone. They kind of outline it. I'm sure the sheriff has seen that at some point. But that's the idea. Now, one of the problems they are having right now, and this is coming directly from the ACLU, is over in the Seattle area, in that basic area, they're already seeing traffic stops set up by federal officers nearly 20 miles from the border, doing checks 20 miles from the border on our side, yes, in that 100-mile zone. I can tell you with authority of law that they have absolutely no delegated authority or no authority in law to do any such thing. And the sheriff over there should not be allowing them to do it. It's not like we have 9,000 terrorists every day floating across the Canadian border. That's just not happening. And one man was taken out of his car and almost stripped naked on the side of the road, according to the ACLU. And they're preparing to do a lawsuit on that right now. Preparing to procure a lawsuit on that. And I mean, and the man didn't have any drugs. He had nothing. They just picked on him for some reason. Maybe he didn't comb his hair that day or something. I don't know. He just looked suspicious for some reason. And I've got a list of what the Department of Homeland Security uses as a profile list. Now, so you can look at that map and kind of get the idea. We won't spend a whole lot of time on that. But Department of Homeland Security has a list like that too. They have a list of what they determine are potential terrorists. But their list is rather skewed against anybody that's what we could be considered a constitutionalist or a real American. I would put it simply, a real American. So in the supposed, according to the ACLU and other individuals, I've looked at several different advocacy agencies' information and from the study of law myself, and I agree with this statement. In a constitution-free zone, the powers granted under the Constitution no longer apply. Any person who falls into the sights of the national security apparatus while in a constitution-free zone is on his own. There is no appeal process, no case law, no Bill of Rights protection, no lawyers, and none of what Americans count on to help them when they have become justly or unjustly identified as having done wrong. Now, again, when you talk to your local elected about these kind of things, they will tend to downplay it. And I understand why they do that. I do. I understand why they do that. And we have a lot of people out here that... Let's go back 15 years ago. If somebody told you 15 years ago that some of the things you see happening today were going to happen, what would you have said? Oh, no, never in America. It's never going to happen. Our government would never attempt to take away our Second Amendment rights. 20 years ago, most of you in this room would have never believed that. Well, I want to tell you the honest truth. 20 years ago, I was telling people that was going to happen, and so were many others. And everything that we were trying to teach people 20 years ago when they were laughing at us has happened. Every single thing. 1, 2, 3, right down the line. And you know how, and I'm not claiming to be some prophet or some genius or something. It's real simple. You study history, and you study the laws of the nation, and all you got to do after that is open your eyes and you can see it. You'll be enlightened. You'll see it. You can see the changes very quickly. And they're subtle sometimes through pieces of legislation and, you know, one little trickle here and a trickle there, and pretty soon it's a flood. Well, we're in the flood now. The gates have been opened. And there's not enough resistance against it. Now, as far as a profile list for the Department of Homeland Security, this comes from their information, from the ACLU. They got this from the Department of Homeland Security. This is their profile list. What can target you? The following actions may get an American citizen living on U.S. soil labeled as a suspect terrorist. This is their, what I call, I retitle it, this is their subversive profile list. Because everything we're experiencing right now is subversive warfare. What does the word subversive mean? It means you take everything and turn it up on its head. You turn it upside down. And that's exactly what they've done. Being young, if you live close to the zone, can be a suspect. So be old and you'll be fine. Using social media, reporting or doing journalism at the wrong place at the wrong time. Speaking out against government policies. Sounds a bit like communism. Protest anything. Questioning war. Criticizing the government's targeting of innocent civilians with drones. Asking questions about pollution, paying cash at the internet cafe. Actually, paying cash one of these days is going to be a telltale sign of people who are not cooperating with the system. That's coming. Right. As everything gets more electronic and more digital, and they want to use cards and chips and everything else. So, asking questions about Wall Street shenanigans, holding gold, creating alternative currencies. And actually, I want to say something on alternative currencies. I have a little problem with some of these groups out here that are trying to suggest alternative currencies, because they're actually, some of them are coming up with ideas and aren't even in the Constitution. They're not in the law. You know, so you got to take this with a grain of salt. Stocking up on more than 7 days of food can get you profiled. Having bumper stickers saying anything like, know your rights or lose them. Investigating factory farming. And then, of course, that's to protect Monsanto's and their march across the country. Infringing a copyright, taking pictures or videos, talking to police officers. Don't talk to the police officers. No. No, you need to talk to your police officers. They're human beings, and so treat them like human beings and hope they treat you like human beings. Wearing a hoodie. Actually, I have to question some people that wear a hoodie. I don't necessarily always disagree with everything on here. Driving a van. Tom, you're a crook. You drive a van. Writing on a piece of paper. Now, why is writing on a piece of paper on that list? If you go back in history, you go back to World War II, look at Hitler, what's one of the things he did when the fascists were taking over Germany? They confiscated all paper from people. Why? They don't want you to have a way to make records, record things, create any kind of notes of currency or notes of exchange, anything like that. Sorry, Rick, you didn't do your job. And they don't want you to have paper. And Lenin did the same thing when communism was coming into Russia, when they were taking over. They confiscated all paper goods. They didn't want anybody writing anything down. So, and I mean, that seems a bit extreme, I understand. But these are just, every one of these things are historical when you think about it. If you go back and look at what's happened to other nations, they're all historical. Being frustrated with mainstream ideologies, valuing online privacy, supporting Ron Paul or being a libertarian. He became a real target of the government because he was exposing their sins. Upholding the founding fathers. Actually, I have a video of a FEMA instruction meeting for police officers back in North Carolina where they stood in that room and told them that our founding fathers were all terrorists. George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, they were all terrorists. Come from one of their seminars. Being a Christian. It's hard to tell that anymore anyway, so. Being anti-tax, anti-regulation, or for the gold standard. Being reverent of individual liberty. Being anti-nuclear. Believe in conspiracy theories. And there's some truth to that, but you know, the problem is about half of all conspiracy theories are actually true. It's just figuring out which ones are true and which ones are not. A belief that one's personal or national way of life is under attack. Impose strict religious tenets or laws on society. Fundamentalist. Anybody that's fundamental in nature will be considered a threat. Insert religion into political sphere. See, that's another ignorant fact where our leaders, elected leaders, don't realize that this entire nation was founded on biblical values in the beginning. There's a big statue back in Massachusetts that they built back then to show exactly that. You walk right around it, tells you the whole story. Those who seek to politicize religion, supported political movements or autonomy. Being anti-abortion. Abortion is against the law. You know why? Because the government doesn't have the delegated authority to fund or uphold it in the first place. So it is already against the law. Being anti-global. Suspicious of centralized federal authority. I'm not suspicious of it. I know it for a fact. Fiercely nationalistic. A belief in the need to be prepared for an attack either by participating in surveillance, kind of weird way to write that. Opposing genetically engineered food. Why do you think we wanted a Food Freedom Act? Because we do have a right to know what's in our food. We do have a right to grow our own food and support ourselves. The way we feel healthy, what makes us healthy, we have a right to support ourselves that way. Opposing surveillance. And that's the list as it is now. So, interesting. Now, one last thing before I get into the main text. Actually, two little things here. And we'll take a little break after this one, just a quick little break. Part of the security apparatus when the Patriot Act first came out was an act called FISA. How many people are familiar with that? FISA, the FISA Act. It's FISA. Okay, you're familiar with that, Jerry? That's the Federal International Security Act. Now, it failed. It actually failed the first time around because there were a few judges around at that time that said, oh, this is so unconstitutional, it just cannot be. Well, and it failed. Well, it's back on the plate. And it looks like it's going to pass this time. And it's been very quiet. I've been looking on the media. I haven't heard anything about it. But our contacts in Washington, D.C. say they're getting ready to vote on it. So it's I'm going to come back. Basically, it's part of the Surveillance Act of the Patriot Act, and basically gives them the right to collect any kind of information they please. Anything. Everything's on the table. And I mean, I'm not going to go through a dissertation on that. I mean, you can use your own imagination. I mean, you know, internet, phones, everything. Everything. Everything's on the table. And you know, it makes me ill when I read that, and then I hear legislators say, but we're going to pass this and we're going to pass that to protect this and keep that from happening. No, they're not. These federal government people are going to do whatever they want to do as long as people allow them to do it.
That's right.
No state government's going to stop them because it doesn't know how. They forgot the law. They don't know how to stop them. And I get a little irritated when I hear public servants stand up and say, well, I'll stand with you on this and I'll stand with you on that, when I can look at the history of the thing and the way things are working and the way the things are being manipulated, and I know better. You know, it's not going to happen. They can't do it without the people's support anyway. They got to have the support of the people. Okay, the one last thing, I want to give you a little background information on the Department of Homeland Security. A lot of people don't even know where it came from. I've had this in my file for a long time, and I kept this information for quite a long time, and I think now's the time to unload it briefly on you, and that is DHS's origin. Actually, they have been an organization or a corporation for over 25 years, even before 9/11. But how many people heard of them before that? No. Well, they were originally called the Homeland Security Company. And they had an office in Atlanta. They had one in Tennessee and one in Kentucky, I believe. They were a big private organization just like Blackwater. Same thing. They were the same thing as Blackwater, big security agency. They already had massive contracts with the federal government. They were already securing a lot of federal government facilities. A lot of times when you go to federal facilities, and when I was in the Marines, I went to several, and I remember seeing these guys in black standing there, like SWAT uniforms standing there. Well, they weren't federal employees. They were employees of Homeland Security Company. Because if you looked on their little tag, you'd see HSC on there. And even then, I was ignorant then. I didn't know any better. I was like, what's HSC? Never heard of it. No, but it was not. Everybody assumed it was another federal alphabet soup agency, but it's not. It wasn't until after 9/11. And then after 9/11, they moved it into the Homeland. They made it the DHS, what we know as now as the Homeland Security, Department of Homeland Security. It's the same company. It's exactly the same company. They've been around a long time. DHS is a private, for-profit corporation, and you can look it up on their corporate website. You can go get all this information. They're a private, for-profit corporation that has existed for over 25 years and have been working with government the entire length of that existence. They have no authority delegated to them by law. They have only executive statutory power. Their only power comes from the executive branch of government. That's it. They can only deceive you into complying or use force to gain your unwilling compliance. That's the only power they have over you, because they have no delegated authority in law whatsoever. Now, of course, there are these people that say HR Bill 1505 died in committee, and I said this earlier, that allowed Department of Homeland Security to take over the 100-mile security zone. Now, that's kind of a silly statement to begin with. In other words, you're admitting there's a 100-mile security zone. Well, they did. They just admitted it. But they said the Department of Homeland Security hasn't been given the authorization by Congress to take over the authority of that zone. Well, again, the Homeland Security is a non-constitutional agency. They don't answer to Congress. They only answer to the president, who is a corporate officer in the corporate federal corporation. And if you want to understand a little bit more about those kind of things, you can actually go to the Delaware State website. And there is one of the best. And you look on their first page, and it'll show you the whole incorporated structure of that government. That they're all a corporation for profit. Not non-profit, for profit. which is actually not within their delegated authority in the first place. So it's pretty interesting. It's the reason they can do a lot of what they do. Now, how many people would like to take about 5 minutes? Anybody need a break? Okay, let's take about a quick 5 minutes and we'll come back. Some of you may have seen some information on one of our newsletters about a remonstrance program, remonstrance plan. I'm not going to get into that too much this morning because there's a lot of preliminary things that have to be done about that, but I am going to work in that direction. But before we can go any further with anything, we have to develop a foundation. What I'm getting ready to do right now is share with you a little lecture that basically encompasses everything we've tried to teach over the last 2 years. Solid, fundamental facts of law based on the Constitution. And I want to go through this, and that is the base. And these things you have to understand. And I actually have all this written, so if anyone afterwards wants to sign up for a copy of this, I'll certainly have it printed. But there's no way we could afford to print that many copies of this. It would have been a lot of money. But I'll make it available to anyone who wants it. It's a pretty concise combination of, I think it's about 2,000 words long. It's about 2,000, something like that. So anyway, I'm going to begin that. But I want to start out by asking a question. And this is the question. How many folks here would say, I support the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of Washington? How many really say, I do? Okay. Well, you know, everybody's going to raise their hand, of course. I expected that. And but, you know, people have been saying that for years. People have been taking oaths for years saying, I support the Constitution and the laws therein and so forth and so on. And they word it different ways in different states and different places. But they've been saying that for a long, long time. I want to ask you another question. If that's true, how in God's name did we get in the place we are today?
Not standing up.
Yes, sir, you're absolutely correct. How can you say you support something if you won't uphold it? You can't. And I'm going to be very adamant about this. Taking an oath or saying I support something that you're not willing to put your combat boots on, not literally, I'm talking about violence now, but I mean you're not willing to kind of put your political combat boots on and get out in the trenches and fight for it, I'm going to make it real plain. You're lying. Amen. What's that beep? Did I do something wrong? Okay. Anyway, I heard a beep. So, along that lines, we the people is not just an expression. You know, I've talked to people around in different places, and especially elected, and you mentioned the Constitution, you mentioned constitutional law, and they look at you like you're stupid. I'm serious. They look at you like you're stupid. Because it just doesn't mean anything to them anymore. But you know, the Supreme Court, I read it a couple meetings ago. I read a Supreme Court decision that said, you know, you can assume and presume that something is law. You can assume and presume you're doing what's right. But that does not excuse you from the effects of the Constitution. In other words, the consequences of what you're doing. It looks like today that government is operating without the idea of consequences. Well, they are. But you know what? Don't worry, folks. There's always consequences for evil. It always catches up. There's consequences for good, too. Sometimes when you take a good stand in a bad place, you end up with some pretty rough consequences upon you, but you did the right thing. And we have a real problem today in our nation with men. Now, you ladies sit there and take a break for a minute. You're off the hook for a minute. And I'll tell you why. Today, and I've said this before, today in our nation, there are more women today taking a stand against tyranny than there are men. God bless them. Where are our men? If the shoe doesn't fit, don't wear it. But if it does, please listen. Where are the men? Now, the next thing I'm going to say might sound a little ugly, but I was talking to somebody the other day, and we were talking about that very thing, about where are the men with backbone today? And I said, well, I told him, I said, Walmart does still sell men's underwear. So you need to tell them to take their panties off and go get some underwear on. That sounds kind of ugly, but you know what? It's true. It's true. And it might sound humorous, but it's absolutely a fact. Our men today, whether it be the Cattlemen's Association, whether it be elected servants, whether it just be the average farmer or whoever out here, our men are not standing up. I have men that tell me, well, you know, if I stand up, I'm going to get targeted. You're already targeted. Well, I moved up here in the mountain to hide. No, you didn't. There's no place to hide. You know, even the scripture tells us in the last day there'd be no place to hide. There is no place to hide, folks. With the kind of surveillance they have at their fingertips today, they know where every rock and grasshopper is. There's no place to hide. You can't hide. So you got two choices. You sit down and become a slave, or you stand up for your freedoms so that your children and your grandchildren might have a little something in the future. That's the bottom line. You don't have a choice. So we the people is not just an expression. It's a phrase that our founding fathers chose to define the true sovereigns of this nation. You go back to the Public Records Act, Section 42. It talks about the people being sovereigns. They've turned that word into a dirty word today. I know there's some sovereignty movements out there that got crazy people in it. I know that. But the word is not a bad word. It's a part of law. Every citizen in America is a sovereign citizen. That means they're sovereign over the government because God created people. People wrote the constitutions that created the government. And somehow that's gotten all subverted. That's completely subverted now. We the people of America, from whom all political power is derived. That's in our Washington State Constitution, Article 1, Section 1. It's the first thing you see there. Then it goes on in that same one to say that governments are created to do what? Protect individual rights. It says that right there in the Constitution. To protect individual rights. Because of a nation of laws, which a constitutional republic is, supports the rights of an individual. A democracy supports the rights of the mob. It's mob rule. That's what we have today. We have a mob, a syndicate, a bunch of criminals running the country now. Make no mistake about it, that's exactly what's happening. And we just need to realize that and admit it. So in that case, and I'll probably say it again, when the individual is standing on the law, he's right. If he's the only one standing on the law, he's the only one that's right. If he's the only one standing on the law, he's the only one that has a right to enforce the law. And he does have the right to enforce the law. I've been told by a prosecutor that I don't have the right to enforce the law. Try me. Yes, I do. I know the law. I know that I do. God knows I do. Because that's a God-given freedom that we have. Can't take that away. When the delegated limited constitutional authority to When we then delegated limited constitutional authority to the government to serve us pursuant to oaths taken, as required by the Supremacy Clause, Sections 2 and 3 of Article 4. All legislative power is vested in Congress. We have no kings in this nation. Do you understand why we say that? We have no kings. The king rule is a form of statutory rule. That's what democracy brings back into play, is a kind of a statutory rule. We don't have a statutory rule in America. We're not supposed to, according to our constitutions. We're supposed to have a rule by law. What did the people do in 1215 with the Magna Carta? They forced the king to sign it, or they were probably going to chop his head off. But they forced him. People understand that. They forced him to sign it because they wanted to live by law, not by the rule of kings. When our forefathers came to America, they had the same thing in mind. We were not going to live by statutory rule. Codes and RCWs and those kind of things is statutory rule. That's not rule by law. Need to understand that. And it's wrong. It's unconstitutional, which means it's against the law. When we say unconstitutional, that means it's against the law. All legislative power is vested in Congress. We have no kings in this nation. The limit to delegated authority to government is found in Article 1, Section 8, Clauses 1 through 18. You need to study that. Go to your United States Constitution and study Section Article 1, Section 8, Clauses 1 through 18. All that is stated therein is the full and only extent of authority. Now, you got to understand that. That's it. Whatever's between those two, that's it. They don't have anything else. That which is not authorized by the Constitution is prohibited by the Constitution. That's a phrase you need to carry with you everywhere you go. That which is not authorized by the Constitutions, whether it be state or federal constitution, is prohibited by the Constitution. That's what delegated authority is all about. If it wasn't delegated to them, they can't do it. Here's a good example of that. I was talking to Steve Parker the other day, one of our commissioners, about this, and we kind of got a good laugh out of this, and I want the sheriff to know I'm not planning on robbing the bank after I say what I'm about to say. But, you know, the law doesn't say that I can't go to the bank at 4 o'clock on Tuesday and rob the bank, does it? No, but obviously we know the law teaches us that if you steal, you're going to get caught, you're going to get prosecuted, you're going to get arrested, because it's wrong. Well, this is the way our federal government thinks today, and many of our state governments think today. Well, it doesn't say I can't do that. That's because you're not supposed to do it. But see, you have to stand there and hold their hand and help them understand that. They don't want to understand it because they want power. When you give men power, they want more power. But that's where the servant mentality has disappeared. If you know you're a servant, you won't try to take the power because you know what's going to happen when you do. You're going to get bit or slapped or put back down. They forgot that. In today's America, because of false education, teachings, political maneuvering, propaganda, and for countless other reasons, many people think that it is the people who must serve government. That's subversion. That is not how our nation was created, and that's not the law. Please understand this. Our government, created by the people, serves us. It does so pursuant to the Constitution, oaths taken to it, and the limited powers delegated by it to government. That is the extent of government's legal and lawful power. That's it. There is no more. Anything beyond that is usurpation of power without authority, insurrection, sedition, and treason. And we have sat by for a lot of years in this country and let them do it. Our Constitution is now and has been for many years the only thing that has kept this nation from outright tyranny. Between our Constitution and the right to bear arms is the only thing we have that's keeping our freedoms, whatever freedoms we have right now. I promise you, I don't care what kind of good intentions your elected servants have, if you laid your weapons down tomorrow, I can guarantee you within a year you'd be in a communist country from one end to the other, every aspect of your life. Because the powers that be would just assume all the authority because you can't do a thing about it. That's exactly what they would do. Our duty is to protect it so it can protect us. If you won't protect the Constitution, it can't protect you. And we have not done that. All laws created by Congress for the American people must be constitutionally compliant or they are null and void without force or effect whatsoever. And that was actually, there's a whole stack of Supreme Court cases that pushed that idea forward. Since the law was created by the people for the people and affects the people, then obviously the people have the right to discuss, deal with, and in law which was created for and which affects them. You have the right to operate within that law and defend yourself in that law. If government which was created by the people denies the people involvement and participation in laws created by and for them, then that government lacks constitutional authority to do so, and those laws from which the people are excluded no longer apply or pertain to the people. See, that's what's happened in our nation is they've created an administrative law that has nothing to do with the Constitution. The only way they can make you obey that administrative law is for you to consent to it. So many people have. And that's why we're in this deep hole we're in, whether it be economically, politically, socially, even spiritually speaking. Because we don't take that stand and we've consented to things that we don't understand. A lot of that has to do with our education system. The Constitution as the supreme law of the land affects all the people, thus it is obvious that the people have not only the right but also the duty and obligation to participate in and openly discuss among themselves the law and our Constitution. If one does not know that he has rights, then he has none. And I've said it a million times in here. If you don't know the law, there is no law. Because if you don't know it, they're going to do whatever they want to do. And that's exactly what happens. It's happened so many times. For example, the people said that tyranny could not happen in Germany, Spain, Chile. All the people there felt in those countries felt very secure in their government and their laws and the way they lived. But what happened to them? If you go back and study their history, they were all wrong. They trusted men in power. You can never, and I don't mean this in the wrong way, but you can never trust men with power. You can't. That's why we set up a government where men were not given power. They were given a place of service, not a place of power. And that's an idea that we have long forgotten. It would be a tragic insult to the millions of Americans who died, were wounded, or severely maimed in the numerous wars of America fought in the name of America for freedom to allow our own government and courts to deny the very rights for which they bravely gave their last full measure of devotion to their country. And folks, that's what we do every day. What's the big push from the political parties? Vote. Just vote. We'll take care of it. We'll take care of the rest. Well, they've done a jolly job of taking care of the rest of it. They've made a big mess out of everything. Those who serve in governments in this nation have gone astray and have forsaken the basic principles upon which America was founded. No elected servant can lawfully introduce, draft, support, or vote for any form of legislation that opposes or contradicts the national and state constitutions in any way whatsoever or oppress the rights secured therein to the people.
Or they're guilty of treason, right?
Exactly. They are guilty of treason when they do that. But see, we don't look at things in that mentality today. We shake hands and agree to disagree and go home and continue to lose everything, basically in the end, because we agree to disagree. No accountability. Every public officer is required to take an oath to the federal and state constitutions, and those who do not have this requirement, such as, you know, public employees that work for government offices, are still responsible under the agent principal oath. In other words, they're still responsible to that oath underneath the elected servant who has the oath to oversee that department. Each oath taker is required to abide by his oath in the performance of his official duties. This means he or she must act only within the limited delegated scope of his or her duties and authority. When he acts outside the specifically delegated limited authority, then he or she essentially acts on his or her own and becomes a renegade. Well, most things that are done today by government are outside the delegated authority. Most everything they do is. That's how far we've come. The Constitution's federal and state are very specific regarding authority. What is not authorized by the Constitution, again, is prohibited by the Constitutions. There is no authority in any form whatsoever that permits an oath taker to engage in actions which contradict, defy, and oppose the very documents to which he or she swore or affirmed his or her oath. It all comes down to these very simple principles and lawful mandates. The oath taker either abides by the Constitution, constitutional mandates imposed upon him or her and through his or her oath, or he or she does not. It's a simple choice. They either do or they don't. The constitutions are the textbooks for how government, federal and state, can lawfully operate. Any actions conducted in violation of the constitutions are unlawful. Period. They're against the law. Any actions. I get arguments all the time with elected about what the RCW says. I don't care what the RCW says. Does the RCW line up with the state constitution? Does it line up with the United States Constitution? If it doesn't exist in my mind. And I am not responsible to uphold it, work with it. I'm not responsible to it. It has nothing to do with me. You got to make that decision for yourself that you're going to take that position. And you got to live it. We reduce everything to these very simple principles. These are points of law. They're not just principles, they're points of law. And they're not being enforced. These points are not being enforced. Beware of the difference between the words lawful and legal. They always get you on lawful and legal. We have an old saying that says, what is sometimes legal is not lawful, and what is sometimes lawful is not legal. And you really need to know the difference between the legal system and the system of law. The legal system is not part of the fundamental constitutional system. It's not part of it. The government in their sphere of action does operate in a legal atmosphere. I'm not going to get into all that and explain how that works inside that corporate sphere of action, but they operate within a legal sphere, and that's okay, as long as they keep it in there. But when they step outside of that under the color of law and try to push that on you, they have violated your constitutional freedoms, your freedoms guaranteed by law. That's what the idea of color of law is all about, a violation of color of law. You can read a lot about the color of law by going to the FBI website. They've got a section on there where they talk about the color of law, and they actually do a pretty decent job of explaining what that means. So you got to be aware of the difference between the two. For an act to be lawful, it must fully comply with all requirements of the Constitution specific to the Bill of Rights. Unfortunately, most of the laws on the books are administrative in nature and rarely, if ever, comply with constitutional mandates. These so-called laws are called legal. That's what legal is. Legal is an administrative system. Well, obviously, the government, inside their sphere of action, has to have an administrative system. They have to. They have to have every corporation out here that has a business has to have some way to operate in their corporation. But that doesn't drag everybody else into it. That's the point. But unless they fully comply with the constitutional mandates, they are not valid laws. Sadly, these legal administrative statutes, codes, regulations, policies operate unchecked under what is called the color of law until they are challenged constitutionally. And that's not being done. They're not being challenged. In fact, I studied this pretty heavy, the attorneys that sit down and write up all these codes and rules and regulations, they intentionally do it the way they do it because they know that the average person out here, average individual out here, doesn't have the money to go running into court every time you don't agree with an RCW. We don't have that kind of money, and they know that. And they know that our county commissioners can't do that either because they don't have the money to do it. Our county doesn't have the money to do it. So we sit here and we get oppressed by all these rules and regulations and we act like we don't know what to do. Well, you just ignore them. That's what you do. You don't pay any attention to them. However, since so few people know the difference between lawful and legal, these administrative laws are seldom challenged in a manner which would show them inferior to the superior law of the federal and state constitutions. Agencies operate on administrative laws, procedures, and policies, which typically violate the rights secured to the people and the constitutions. I just explained that. There is no constitutional authority for the creation of administrative agencies. Did you know that? There's absolutely no place in the constitutions to create administrative agencies like Department of Homeland Security and many, many others, the FEMA, EPA, ATF, you could go on and on and on and on and on and on. There is absolutely no delegated authority in the Constitution to create any such agencies whatsoever. All of those agencies have absolutely no authority over the American people. They are inside Article 1, Section 8, Clauses 1 through 18. Wherever they can fit in there, that's where they fit in, as far as the executive branch of government goes. But they absolutely have nothing to do with us. They never should have been created in the first place. All they do is soak up billions of dollars every year in tax revenues. That's what they do. Most people don't realize that we never needed those organizations. We already had organizations that were protecting us through intelligence networks and stuff. Every military branch at one time had their own intelligence operation. And they were doing a fine job. But it didn't suit the big government idea. Didn't suit them, so they wanted more. So, however, since so few people know the difference between legal and legal, these administrative laws are seldom challenged in the manner which would show them inferior to the superior law of the federal and state constitutions. These agencies operate on administrative laws, procedures, and policies which typically violate our rights. There is no constitutional authority for these agencies, as already said. So you should become extremely familiar with the federal constitution specific to the Bill of Rights in Article 1, Section 8. You need to go through that Section 8, Article 1, Section 8, and really study that. And you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. You'll know that everything I'm saying is absolute fact and truth. It cannot be refuted. Not a judge in America that could bring me in a courtroom and refute one bit of what I've said. He can't. He cannot do it because it's fact. He can break the law, I guess, and throw chains on me and throw me in the jail until I change my mind, but I'll never change my mind. If one is going to speak about his rights, he must first know what those rights are, and secondly, he must know the limitations imposed upon government. Article 1, Section 8 covers this regarding the federal government. We should also scrupulously research the powers and authority delegated by the people through their state constitutions also. And we frequently get in state constitutions in little booklets and make them available to people. We've done that. And if you would like, I think we're getting ready to order some more of them. So if you want one, come to one of our meetings, and we should have them at some point in time here. I don't have a specific date. In a constitutional republic such as America, every state is guaranteed a republic form of government pursuant to Article 4, Section 4. Does our legislature ever look around the state and see if we still have a republican form of government in the state? No, not really. This means that the government operates under the rule of law, not under the rule of man. That's the difference between a republic and a democracy. In this country and in every state, the rule of law is the Constitution, since it is the supreme law of the land, and every state constitution says so, as declared in Article 4. Therefore, since legislative powers are vested in Congress pursuant to Article 1, Section 1 of the federal Constitution, and in similar authorized delegations of power to your state legislature in your state constitution, then valid law can only arise by and through the duly enacted legislation of Congress and or the state legislature. Further, all legislative laws must be constitutionally compliant, specific to the Bill of Rights, or they are null and void without force or effect. However, that requires enforcement. That's where we, the people, have let it down. Where's the enforcement? There is no enforcement. We just let it happen. Public officers are required to take oaths of office. Again, the oath is required by the federal constitution, state constitution, federal law, state law, and sometimes county and local law. Therefore, it is well established, lawfully and legally, that the oath is constitutionally and statutorily required, no exceptions. There are absolutely no exceptions. Thus, pursuant to their oaths, public officers must abide by the constitutions in the performance of their official duties. The oath is given in exchange for a public trust, and the oath taker is lawfully bound to uphold that public trust. The First Amendment guarantees the right of free speech and the right to petition government for the redress of grievances, which the oath taker, pursuant to his oath, is mandated to uphold. If he fails this requirement, then he has violated two provisions of the First Amendment, the public trust and perjured his oath. Further, by not responding and or not rebutting the oath taker denies the citizen remedy, thus denies the citizen constitutional due process of law as stated within the Bill of Rights. How many times have you been in public meetings with your commissioners and other elected people and really felt like that the people are actually absolutely have no voice at all? Just about every time, yeah. Because they're running off an administrative process, not a constitutional process. They're running off of legalities, not what's lawful. An American citizen can expect and has the right and duty to demand that his government officers uphold their oaths to the constitutions and abide by all constitutionally imposed mandates of their oaths. This is an unenumerated right guaranteed in the Ninth Amendment. No oath taker has the authority to defy and deny the very document to which he swore an oath and to which he owes his limited delegated authority. The oath taker must act within the lawful scope of his duties and authority. Pursuant to the Delegation of Powers Clause within the 10th Amendment, no power is delegated to any oath taker to deny, defy, or oppose the very document to which he swore his oath. So that doesn't leave him any place to go if you're willing to enforce it. You don't have to agree. They can't pass some ridiculous law or some ridiculous code or some kind of a statute without the consent of the people. But they do it all the time. They do it all the time. The feds have no lawful authority over the citizens of the... Let's talk about the federal government then. The feds have no lawful authority over the citizens of the several states and no lawful authority over the county sheriff. Our sheriff should... He knows this. Our sheriff should know this. However, this lawful position must be lawfully demanded and imposed by the people. It still has to be opposed by the people. Imposed by the people, rather. And there are many sheriffs around the country who have basically sold their allegiance by taking federal grants. I know there's a controversy there, and they would argue that. But let me tell you something, folks. You cannot take money from a federal government from another jurisdiction into another jurisdiction where they have no delegated authority. If you take their money, you take them. There's no way to argue that. You take their money, you take them. And you're going to cooperate with them whether you want to or not if you take their money. And you're going to do what they want you to do eventually. You may put up a fight at first, but you're eventually going to do what they want you to do if you take their money. And by the way, there's no delegated authority in the constitutions for any federal government to give any state or any county money, federal grants. That all happened as of 1968 through 1972 through the Regionalism Act. That's where that thing was created. People fought it. There's a few congressmen that fought it. There were judges that said it's unconstitutional. For some reason, the whole Supreme Court left and went on vacation and went to sleep. And they just let it happen because they had a plan. It was an agenda that they had. They had to break down the local jurisdictions and take the power away from the people to do what they want to do. So if he's already taken that kind of thing, then he's pretty much in the pocket under the control of the feds. And why haven't we, the people, recognized and stopped this unconstitutional usurpation of power and authority that's not delegated? There are other things, too. A lot of our sheriffs around the country and commissioners and governors have joined all these associations that were, again, created in the 1960s and 1970s. All of those associations are socialist associations. They're a socialist-type system. They are not delegated in the constitutions. There's no authority for it. We now find ourselves in the 100-mile security zone by which we are by which the area allegedly becomes a federal territory, in which the security rights guaranteed to people will not be upheld by the government. Now, we can argue all day long, your sheriff's going to do this, your county commissioners are going to do that. No, the whole thing has to be stopped, or nobody's going to stop anything. You cannot cooperate with this system at all because all of it is unlawful. Remember, what is not authorized in the Constitution is prohibited by the Constitution. Did Washington State cede this land in question to the federal government? And if so, then by what lawful authority has it ceded it? Now, wait a minute. Let's stop there a second. That's pretty interesting. You see that map that you have? Do you know how many people in Washington State, if you look on about the second or third page, it gives you, Washington State will be listed there, and it'll show you how many people are in that zone in Washington State. The majority of the state. How much was it? 93% of the people in the state of Washington are in that zone. Well, we might as well just get the rest of them then and take the rest of the state because there's not much left as far as people go. There's a lot of land, but not much people. Not many people left. You know, and there's absolutely no authority in law for them to do any such thing. And they're already, no matter what the sheriff in any county says, no matter what the commissioners in any county says, they're already exercising that authority illegally and unlawfully. They're already setting up checkpoints around in different places and doing and carrying out these actions that they have no delegated authority to do. It's already happening. They don't care what Congress says. Congress, if you haven't noticed, over the last few years, we don't have a Congress. They're just a big gang up there that gets paid a whole lot of money to do absolutely nothing. There's no constitutional authority delegated to anyone by the Constitution to create, again, alphabet soup agencies such as DHS, EPA, DOE, etc., etc. However, the American people in their long history have never upheld their rights, never protected or enforced their constitutions, never ensured that due process of law would be upheld and provided for them, never protected their currency, and of course, mindlessly fought all sorts of wars for money, power, and for the elite of this nation, none of which they ever knew or for which they were ever concerned. We paid for all of that stuff. All of their little shenanigans around the world. We've paid for that. We go to a country like Iraq, we bomb the living daylights out of the thing, and then we let the American taxpayers pay to build it back. That makes a lot of sense. Now, I wonder why we're broke. When people do not protect their own rights, they deserve the unjust treatment they get from evil, abusive governments that they allow to exist and flourish. So again, I've said a million times in here, you can't blame the government for this. It's not the government's fault. When you give men power outside the law, they're going to do exactly what men do when they have power outside the law. They're going to do that. The question now becomes, how many people in this jurisdiction will stand up for their rights and lawfully oust any unconstitutional officer in the county, or his deputies, or anybody else that works in the county government that won't uphold the law or keep their oaths. We've got to remember there's strength in numbers. If that number remains small, then we'll get what we deserve. We'll get what we deserve. If the number is large, or at least visibly vocal and lawfully committed, then there are several courses of action that are open to us. And that'll be coming down the road, but there are... And is anybody familiar with Oak Harbor? What happened in Oak Harbor, Washington? Yeah. Take a look at that. Go on YouTube. It's on YouTube, isn't it? Yeah, it is. Go take a look at that. The people set their foot down, and they got what they wanted. They stopped it. Cold in its tracks. It can be done. It doesn't have to let it happen, people, and they proved it. Now, another place that's been very instrumental with their people is Maine. Maine has had a lot of success in Maine with this thing called remonstrance. They've had a lot of success there with their local governments and even their state legislature. They took it all the way to the state legislature and straightened out a couple of things. And there were some specific items. But it does work. When the people are ready to stand, it does work. Because they don't have a choice. Quitting is not an option, and self-government is not a spectator sport. You know, that's basically where we've been all these years. We've had we've had what we call self-government. It hasn't been self-government at all. Because we've been a bunch of spectators. We've been mesmerized with football games and basketball games and baseball games and all the entertainment. We've just lived a pretty good life, pretty easy life. And that's one of the problems, is that we have just had it a little too good to really pay attention to what big government's doing. We've had it a little too good to realize how the political parties were used to distract us from everything that the government was really doing. And again, I want to tell you, the political parties have absolutely no authority in law to do anything. They are an election machine, and that is it. And they went way beyond that. They influence a lot of law and different things like that, and that's wrong. They don't have any authority to do any such thing. And that's been used to subvert everything we know. Now, so what's the plan? What do we do? What's the plan? The plan is we must call out all people who value liberty and prepare them to come when called. That involves everybody in this room. You can't keep this to yourself. So many people practice undercover patriotism. We used to have a term called undercover Christians, didn't we? You know, you got an undercover patriotism. We got a lot of undercover patriots out there that, I support the Constitution, sort of. You know, I support the law, sort of. I believe in America a little bit. But they won't take a stand. So we can no longer sit on the sidelines and expect someone else to fight our battles. Now, there's a couple of good stories. I know Doug and Paul both have an experience, a story that friends of mine there, that they've had experience when they were young and rough and wild and crazy and going down the road in the car and start mouthing off to some other guys in the car, and they want to get a big fight started, and one of them's more boisterous than the other, and he jumps out of the car and says, "All right, let's go." But the only problem is all the other guys came out of the other car, but he's standing there alone because everybody else stayed in his car. Yeah, you know about that, don't you, Paul? Yeah. All of a sudden, it's 4-5-1. You know, well, that's kind of what's happened. You get your Matt Shays that go over there and take a stand on something, and he's ridiculed. Treated like scum when he's standing on what's right. It's the same thing. It happens all the time. Where's the support? There's people that support him, but not enough. It takes more than that. The Stevens County Assembly has been treated the same way. You get a little body of people here, and then all of a sudden, all these rumors start flying around the community. Oh, they're in the militia, or they're a sovereignty group, or, you know, people start spreading all these rumors. And some of those rumors were spread by the people in the political parties. I know that for a fact, because I got a call right after it happened, directly from the source. You know, that's what happened. So what are they protecting? They're afraid that you might learn something. They're afraid that you might learn the truth. They're afraid that you might be woke up out of the darkness you've been sitting in for the last 40 or 50 years. They're afraid you might affect this illegal system, an unlawful system that's taking place right now, that's taking precedence over everything. That's what they're afraid of. They're afraid to lose their position. Well, I'm all for taking their position away from them. Whatever manner it has to be taken away. We must remember it has always been the minority that has stood up and paid the price for freedom. A constitutional republic, again, recognizes the freedoms of individuals, where a democracy is mob rule and ignores individual freedoms. As such, one man or woman standing on the law or a truth has the right to enforce and uphold the same. One man is a majority in the law when he is lawfully correct. You got to remember that. But one man is not going to get it done. You go to a courtroom today, and I've been in courtrooms several times, not because I've been in trouble, don't get me wrong, but I've been in courtrooms several times. And I have seen people absolutely abused. I have seen judges break the law. But the guy standing didn't know that, because he didn't know who he was when he stepped into the courtroom. He wasn't a free man when he stepped through that gate, because he didn't know he was a free man. He didn't know that they had to produce some evidence that he actually broke a fundamental, common law. And they didn't. They just came up with some illegality. Now, what they do today through all these codes and things like that, they create all kind of fines, rules and regulations. And believe me, folks, every one of us every day break one of them, because there's no way you can't. There's too many of them. Thank goodness most of the attorneys can't remember them all either. So, but there's so many of them, you just can't do it. Expanding on the principle, when a body of people in unity and the fear of God go forth in law, they have the right to correct the unlawful actions of their servants. To disallow such an action is treason and tyranny. It is a definition of tyranny when you don't let people go through the process of redress of grievances in a lawful manner and actually have success. Because if you fight against their success, you're committing treason against the law, against the constitutions, and against the people. We can no longer hide and hope for a better time. There's so many people that are sitting around thinking, it's going to get better, don't worry. I've heard that from business owners especially. They're the worst. It's going to get better. And I understand why they want to believe that. Believe me, I understand the burden that's on them. I know why they want to say that. But it's not going to get better until they step out of there and do something about it. There is no place to hide, no place to run. All of the landscape around us has been surveyed, and the eye in the sky nearly sees all. There is no secret place in the hills to hide these days, folks. There is none. What you need to do as a people, you've got to start going door to door, neighbor to neighbor, friend to friend, family to family, and you got to be convincing and truthful about what's going on. You got to wake these people up and tell them there is a process that we can start pushing back against this at a local level, and we can. I know we can. I'm not afraid to say that. I don't care who's in this room today. I know we can. Because there's only one thing that would stop me from doing what's right, and that's a bullet right between my eyes. That's the only thing that's going to stop me. That's not a challenge, by the way. So I'm not in a hurry. So, but I'm telling you, that's how it is. I'm not going to stop. And you need to be that way too. Again, as we're back to the one man thing. One man jumps out of the car and nobody else does, we got a problem. But there is a way, and there is an apparatus available to us to get our local government to conform to the rule of law. Now, I'm not accusing our local government of being lawless. We have a real problem today. And it's not that we have malicious people in government. Because we got some good people in there. We're so far from the constitutional processes today that they don't know them. We're going to have to help them. I'm telling you, folks, we're going to have to help them conform to the rule of law. As the law teaches us that all fiduciaries who have violated supreme law are automatically dismissed. Actually, there's principle in law that says if you violate your oath of office, you're already out of office. That office is vacant. Now, trying to enforce that's another thing. But that's the truth. That's what the law teaches us. Now that process, I'm not going to get very far into it because I'm going to let you go here real soon. But this is something that has to be done. And I'm going to get into, I'm going to make some pretty definite statements here, because there's only one way this is going to work, is that we're serious about it. This 100-mile security zone is coming, whether you like it or not. I don't care what any local servant says, it's coming. There's nothing they're going to do to stop it by themselves. Not by themselves. And they have a way of sneaking this stuff in here subtly without arousing too much attention. They've been doing it for years. They've been doing it for a long time. Through little pieces of legislation, little rules and regulations, a little here and a little there, until it's all over you and you can't get it off. We got to stop that. So what we need to do is begin the process of remonstrance. And what that is, here's a definition. Remonstrance is a formal protest against the policy or conduct of government or certain officers drawn up and presented by aggrieved citizens. Now, it's not an actual protest like... Now, by the way, that comes from the Black's Law Dictionary. I didn't make that up. It's been around. It's only been around for 800 years. And it was practiced earlier in our nation. A long time ago, it was practiced quite often. In fact, if you Bible thumpers, if you want to read about remonstrance, go to, I'll give you the right one, chapter 5 of, is it Nehemiah chapter 5? Yeah. Nehemiah chapter 5. That's remonstrance. Nehemiah practices remonstrance with the local government. And when he got to the end of his remonstrance, they didn't have a choice, because what was the next step? He was going to wrap his hands around their throat and throw them out through the front gate. And that's exactly what the Declaration of Independence says for you to do when they won't obey the law. And the Declaration of Independence is law. Whether people want to admit it or not, it is. So, but the first part of that, just to give you an overview, is we present a presumptive letter. And I'm not going to go through what that is right now, but there's not time, but it would take a lot of education. But we're going to present a presumptive letter. We're going to present, number two, present and require them to sign a constitutional affidavit. We have the right to have them sign a constitutional affidavit. And they don't have anything to worry about. It's not like we're going to make up a bunch of stuff and put in there. No, it's a constitutional affidavit based on the law. Facts only. And if they can't sign it, they violate their oath of office automatically, because they have to sign it. They don't have a choice. They have to sign it. Then the last process, C, the third process, is the actual remonstrance, where you practice what's in the First Amendment of the Constitution. You have a right to do what? Redress of grievances. This is the process of how you do that. The Constitution doesn't spell it out, but this was done after the Constitution was written. But this is that process. It took me a long time to put it together, to find it. I finally got a hold of some people who knew the process, had actually practiced it, have had 250 successful cases of using this all over the country. It does work if the people are behind it, but the people have to be behind it. One of the principles you need to remember: you never negotiate your freedoms nor the law. You don't negotiate law with people. You don't negotiate freedoms. You get in a conversation with somebody talking about what the law says, and all of a sudden they want to direct you toward codes and rules and regulations, you're in a bad conversation. You're wasting your time. You talk about law, you talk about law. It means what it says. They are non-negotiable. You demand compliance or you remove rebellion. That's the principle of law. You demand compliance or you remove rebellion. That's how it works. That's the only way it can work. So I have all the documents and information to forward such a process. We simply have no choice at this point. We need to do this, because this thing is getting out of control. Now, I don't have any delusions that we're going to correct all the problems. Don't think I do. I don't. But you got to start somewhere. You got to start pushing back pieces and parts at a time and making some headway. You've got to do it. And we've got some commissioners up there that don't like a lot of things that are going on. But they're not going to change it all by themselves. They're not going to do it. They're going to have some help. Now, I'm going to get a little personal here with you, and this is necessary, and this is, I'm going to kind of lay down the law on behalf of Russell Bolton here now, okay, for myself. Now, and you can take this however you want to, but this has to be done. This has been put off way too long. I've spent, for the most part, my own money and countless hours and 20-plus years working at this kind of thing for all these years. Ever since I've been out of the Marines, I've been doing this kind of thing. We are at the point in which we move forward and fully commit to this cause, or we stop everything and prepare for what we deserve if we don't do it. We can't wait any longer, because later you will not be able to do it. You won't have the ability to do it later. I will not fight nor represent a people who will not commit to this cause, or who will furthermore not support it. I have no funds remaining to do this, nor should I. I've spent all my money over the last 2 years on everything we've done. I'm serious. There's no more. It's time to put your money where your beliefs are. It will take countless hours of preparation, instruction, and meetings with local elected to make this work. I cannot do this unless fully supported to do so. In fact, I will not do it unless fully supported to do so. This is D-Day for Mr. Bolton. This is the last blast for Mr. Bolton. I'm tired. We are in the 11th hour. No more politics, no more compromises, no more lies, no more party correctness, and no more pretending to support the Constitution that we will not uphold. You got to stop pretending that you support it. Now it's time to prove it. Everyone in this room can give $5 or $10 a month to see this through. Everyone in our county. I'm talking to people in our county. I really shouldn't even have to ask for it, to be honest, but I feel bad to do that. I really do. I feel bad to have to, but there's cost involved in this. I can't just go out and take my credit card and say, we're going to do this. Well, then I'm the one doing it. You're not doing it. You know, it's got to be everybody. Someone has to make this stand and do the work required, and it's a full-time job. It's going to be a full-time job trying to make this happen. It is. It's going to be a full-time job. I've got a lot of research to do, and thank God I got a wife and daughter that can type faster than I can. So this is my last blast. If it is not financially and physically supported, I humbly submit to you that Russell Bolton is done. I have fought this thing for 20-some years, and I'm not trying to be big-headed. Uh-oh, I'm about to be arrested now. And supported. And do you want to say something?
Nope, you're being supported.
Okay. And thank you, fellas. But, you know, a people who will not fight for their freedom and support those who will fight for their freedoms deserve whatever happens to them. They really do. They really do. And I love every one of you guys. I really do. But I tell you what, after 20-some years of this, after my wife and family, honest to God, before the Lord, having to put up with me, and I'm serious about this, don't laugh, that's true, have to put up with me for the last 20 years over this stuff, believe me, they deserve a lot more than I do.
Well, you're not going to fight alone, I'm with you.
Well, thank you, man, I appreciate that. And we, thank you very much, but they've had to put up with a lot. They've had to put up with a lot. And back in North Carolina, I want you to make me cry now. back in North Carolina, we had many challenges from even the FBI that challenged us at that time. And my goodness, this was not what I had planned. So maybe I should just shut up. So I will not pretend or play games. We'll not do that anymore. We're going to do this, or we're going to sit down and quit. Because I'm going to be done if we don't. So, okay, I think you are. Thank you. And this, and I know everybody here does. I don't expect everybody to come up here, and we don't have to do it that way either. But we do have some facility charges we need to take care of today. But you know, there's some people working to set up a support system for this. And it's not completely put together yet, but it's going to take a lot of hours and a lot of days to do this. And I am committed to success. I'm committed to see it done. And what you people have just done by standing up here in front of some of your elected people, you've just proven that it can be done.
Yeah.
that it can be done. If, and then, you know, if, yes, sir.
If we do not do it now, we never will.
We won't. And you know why? Because that's the way things in God's universe works. God challenges people in every generation to do certain things. And when they don't stand up and do it, that chance does not come back to you again. And every time you lose something, you don't get it back. You lose some of your freedoms, you will not get them back. You will never get them back. So I'm going to work toward this. I can see I don't have to really say much more about it. I'm going to get busy on this thing and start putting this together. If you're not on our newsletter list, please sign up back there and you'll get our newsletter. Even if you're not from our county, at least you'll know what's happening. And obviously, I'm willing to... You can take that back there. Thank you, sir. And we can...
This is a start.
You can take it back there. Okay. Thank you. And... But I'm willing to go to any of the surrounding counties and share this information that I have and help get you started. If you want some people that want to get a hold of it and do the same thing in your county, I can certainly make that available to you. And I've still got a lot of time to spend talking to the people back in Maine because they knew what they were doing. I mean, they did it right and they were successful. And so I'm going to work with them very closely. I'm going to be talking to our county commissioners and working with them very closely. We got a couple pretty good county commissioners in there now. And we need to get in there and we need to get in there with them, kind of help direct them, kind of let them know they're supported and that they can do great things because the people are behind them. But everybody here has got to multiply yourself. You got to go out of here and multiply yourself. You got to let people know what's going on. You guys can sit down if you want to. You don't have to keep standing. You can multiply. Thank you guys very much.
We need to make sure that they know this has to be every month support.
Right. Okay.
Every month.
All right. And we'll send out some more information. Oh, thank you. There's some more information on our... We'll send out more information, more detailed information on our newsletters as time goes on. So please get on our newsletter. Now, I want to say something really quick about our newsletter. I made the administrative decision of taking a few people off our email list lately. Don't take that too hard. There were some security concerns because of some phone calls I got. Some were from people who were connected with federal law enforcement. And so I do have to be careful. And I don't want to bring any reproach to anything. But there's always somebody out there trying to mess something up. There's always somebody out there trying to do that. And so hopefully that will be reinstated as soon as everything's cleared up. It looks like it's headed in that direction now. It's going to be cleared up. So we'll get that taken care of pretty soon. But you're not alone in this. If the people in Oak Harbor could do it, if the people in Maine can do it, there's no reason we can't do it. There's no excuse. And there's other places in the country, too, that have done similar things, too, but not this official process. This is the official constitutional process for monstrances. And if you've got a Black's Law Dictionary, you can look it up in there. You can look up the word, and it'll explain to you exactly what it is. Our elected servants have the duty to protect us. And if there are agencies out there that are saying that they're going to control what we can plant, what we can grow, and this thing. And that's really what the idea of the food freedom was to make a statement that we still know who we are. We still know we have the right to grow and produce and sell to our neighbors if we want to, and it's none of the government's business. And it had nothing to do with commercial operations or anything like that. It was only independent people on their own private property. Because that has been challenged by the FDA and USDA. Unfortunately, we have a lot of people in this country that think the USDA and the FDA are legitimate government organizations. They are not. They have no authority over the people in America. We better get that in our head.
Yes, ma'am. And Mr. Lonsman's, Russell, regarding this 100-mile security zone, who is that addressed to?
Well, it will start at the local level. And then we could work it all the way up to the legislative level. It starts here, though. But it's a process we have to go through. You start out with a presumptive letter, which basically opens up the door. It has certain sections of the presumptive letter are constitutionally the same every time. And then you fill in the middle with your abbreviations and things like that.
Will you be filling that out?
Once I get it all together, I would certainly, obviously, I'm going to, anybody that wants a copy of it can have it.
Spoon feeding is a good thing.
Right. And I have learned that, and there's a reason I'm doing this the way I'm doing it. I've seen this happen so many times. A group of people get together, come up with a great idea, and they spread their stuff out all over the place, all their information. Next thing you know, Tom over here and Jerry over there wants to do it themselves, but they don't do it according to law. You get all these different people doing different things, and it just messes up the whole thing, and the whole thing's blown away. I don't want that to happen. We got to work together on this and keep it within the body of people that understand and want to do it.
Can I just clarify one point? Your support right now, what you're asking for, if I hear you correctly, is support in the 100 mile that they're trying, or is it?
It will cover every aspect of anything that's unconstitutional.
Okay,
but the remonstrance can be written up specifically for one thing. It can be written up for several things. So it depends on what you want to tackle. You just choose your battles, and those are the ones you pick. Sir?
If I could say something to the group, I would appreciate it. It comes out of the Constitution of the United States. It says, no state shall make or enforce any law that abridges the amenities or the privileges of the citizens of the United States.
That's right.
That is forbidden.
That's right. Absolutely.
That's a license plate, driver's license, everything. It goes right back to the base.
Right. He is correct. But, you know, as I've always told you, we choose our battles carefully.
Right.
And right now we have some really heavy issues that need to be dealt with. And we'll certainly tackle those first, and then we'll, you know, later on, we'll see what else comes up. But, I make no illusion that this is going to be easy. Nothing's easy. Because, unfortunately, we are surrounded by an ignorant society today that knows nothing about the law. They don't know the history of the country. And can you imagine the generation of kids we have coming out of the public schools today being part of the government one of these days? It's a horrifying thought. They're not equipped. In fact, some of the antics I've seen from the Obama administration are absolutely adolescent. Absolutely adolescent. I've never seen such adolescence in government before. Anyway, yes.
I'd like to tell everyone too, it couldn't have been easy when they stood their ground in Concord and Lexington.
No, it wasn't.
Just remember that.
Now, as far as support for the project and support so that I can keep doing this, that support will have to continue monthly and as long as it needs to, you know, until we get a better economy, things like that. And again, I hated to even say anything about it, but there's no way we can do this. We pay people to represent us through our taxes. And then they raise our taxes, and then they get raises, and then so forth and so on. And yet, you look at what's happening around you. It's just common sense. It's common sense. Why do we keep paying these people to accomplish nothing? And actually, even when you pass a good piece of legislation today, it just muddies the waters even more. Because we need to go back. There's one of my favorite verses in Scripture is, seek the old path, wherein is the good way. Well, the path America started out on was the right path. And we're not going to get back there tomorrow, but we have the duty and the opportunity to start today. And we can do that, and we need to. We've got to. It's just a matter of choice. Anyway, so that's all I'm going to go through now. There will be other meetings on this, and we will get more detailed as time goes on. Our newsletters will come out. And ma'am?
Because you keep talking about monthly support. Do you have some way of setting that up?
Well, that's being worked on. See, I wasn't really ready for all that. I didn't know this was going to happen.
The email list, is that something that we could count on?
Yes, yes. We'll put out that information and let you know how that's going to work. And we got some people working on that already. And in fact, they volunteered to do it. I didn't start it. They, you know, we've been at this for a while. And again, I have to turn the attention really to my wife and my family, because they're the ones that have suffered my shenanigans, you know, all of my efforts and things. They're the ones that suffer through it. You know, you got to realize, like some of you may can share this experience, but I'm a Marine. I'm a soldier. I'm used to digging in and fighting the battles, and I don't mind being shot at, as long as I don't get hit. But, you know, and I'm over the line. But, you know, that's kind of the way it is. So nobody wants to get hit, but if you got to take a hit, you got to take one. That's just how it is. And you got to be willing to. So, but again, thank you all for coming. There'll be a lot more information coming out. I'm going to go to work on this. Now that I see we have good support for it, I'm going to go to it. Sir, where? Paul.
I just want to say, in order to support this effort financially, there's probably a lot of people in this room who would have some great ideas for local fundraisers.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, it's much easier, though, if you can get committed people, because the idea, I was called by a former county commissioner the other day, and I was scolded to no end. I was scolded from my head to my toes on this thing. And he told me, he goes, Russell, if you go through with this and you don't get the financials backing so that you can work on it full time and stay on it, he goes, you are a fool. He goes, and you should not do it, because it's not about the money, it's about people committing to the cause. And if you don't have the commitment, then it ain't going to happen. That's right. So anyway, all right. Well, that's all. Okay, so that's all I have today, sir.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Just like a decision. I'll have to be honest with you. Up until probably yesterday before, I really didn't know a lot about this 100-mile thing that you're talking about here.
Get in the mic.
Oh, there's a mic right here. Yeah.
Okay. Like I was trying to say, I guess my voice isn't powerful enough. Up until yesterday, or maybe a little bit before that, wasn't really too much actually aware about this 100-mile thing that was discussion about today. How this came to my attention yesterday was I got a phone call from someone who had been contacted by Matt Shea's office. Evidently, somebody had called him and had told their officer that I, the Stevens County Sheriff, had a meeting with the FBI, Homeland Security, or somebody. And during that meeting, I was told that this was going to be done. It wasn't a lot I could do about it, and basically just acquiesced to it. I'm here to tell you that meeting never happened. I have never spoke with the FBI about this, Homeland Security, BLM, ATF, DEA, any other alphabet, as Russell puts it, from the federal government. I have never, ever spoken to anybody in the federal government about this. So if anybody told you that, or anybody indicated or led you to believe that I have, they're lying, plain and simple. They are a liar if anybody told you that occurred. In the last little over two years that I've been the sheriff of Stevens County, I've had one citizen come to me to complain about being contacted by someone from Homeland Security. Come to find out, it was one of my deputies. It was just, they thought it was Homeland Security. It wasn't, it was an honest mistake. But it was one of my deputies that had contacted that person. So, going back, there hasn't been any documented cases of anybody from Homeland Security or the FBI stopping people for having anything to do with this 100-mile thing. So what I want to tell you people is, if you do experience some contact with Homeland Security, the FBI, or whatever, that they're invoking this 100-mile thing here in Stevens County, I would like to know about it. Call me. Write down when it occurred, where. If you get, if it's Homeland Security, more than likely it's going to be Border Patrol. They wear uniforms. They all have a name tag right here. They're embroidered on. Should be easy to get the name. If not, they'll give it to you. Get the information. Write it down. What transpired. Why they say they stopped you. And just everything you can. And call me. Call me at the sheriff's office. If I'm not there, I will return your call as soon as I get it. We can track this, find out what occurred, and at least find out what happened, and whether it was lawful, whether unlawful, whatever, but at least we know about it, we can document it, and go from there. But I need to know, because if you don't tell me, I'm not out there on every road in Stevens County all day long, and neither are my deputies. We're just not. So if you don't tell me that this is occurring and have documented places and times and names where I can check it back, I just can't say, you just can't come to me and say, yeah, Joe Smith over here said some time ago he was stopped by this guy, because then it may be a story. I don't know. We need actual incidents, times, dates, names, places. Get me that stuff. Get me those things where I can check into it and make sure that people that are out here enforcing the laws, or whatever the laws you think they may or may not be, that they're doing it correctly. But I need to have this information. If I don't, I can't do it for you. I need to have this info. Yeah.
Sir, Val, would you be prudent rather than be to be reactive? Mm-hmm. Now that you have this information, would you be prudent to be proactive for your citizens and put out a notice that that will not happen in your county? You have the jurisdiction.
Well, again, I can't guarantee, right. I can say that, what I can say is, I can't guarantee this, for example, it could be happening right now, but I don't know what's occurring.
Right, but wouldn't
right.
it be rather
than sure.
out of this room?
Right.
Rather than waiting
yeah.
for it to happen?
I can do that. But again, I still need to know, because just because I say so doesn't mean it's not going to happen, is what I'm trying to get across. Mm-hmm. I can say so all the things in the world, but I'm not down on Garden Spot Road right now, am I? And maybe somebody's getting stopped by on Garden Spot Road by a Border Patrol one, which I don't know why they would be there, but if they are, I don't know that. And if people don't tell me that it occurred, then I will never know that. I need to have this information so I can do something with it. Yeah.
I'm sorry, but I don't hear you saying that you're on our side. What is your stand on this in relation to the federal government initiating this? I'm not hearing you say
right.
what side of the fence you're really on.
Well, I don't believe that there's any reason why they should be stopping you away from the border. What there's behind them for stopping you away from the border?
The American people against this 100-mile border.
Oh, you bet. There's no reason why they need to stop somebody. The three things that they would have to prove if they did stop you away from the border, okay? The three things that they would have to prove, not saying that this is right, wrong, or indifferent, but the three things they'd have to prove is, one, basically that you actually did cross the border recently. Two, the object of their search has not changed, which means they can only search for a Border Patrolman isn't going to stop you to see whether you got stolen goods from a burglary over here at a house in Chewelah. The only thing they're going to do is, are you an illegal alien yourself? Are you transporting illegal aliens? Or do you have some type of contraband that should have never come across the border? Those are the only things they can really stop you for, okay? And thirdly, to make a stop, they would have to have a reasonable suspicion of criminal activity, not just the fact that, hey, he's got a blue car and I don't like blue cars, I'm going to stop this guy. They would have to show those three things to even make it valid to begin with, whether you believe it or not. I don't agree with this 100-mile thing, so I'm telling you right there, I don't agree with it. I'm not in support of it.
Sir, did you give up your jurisdiction?
No, but the problem is, they can't stop you even for reasonable suspicion when they have no jurisdiction in your county in the first place.
Well, and again,
at the border, yes.
And again, like I'm going to say, it's going to, again, when you get back to the, who's going to say whether something's constitutional or not? Is it me? Is it you? Is it Russell? Again, it's going to come down to the court interpreting
nope.
that, isn't it?
No.
It's not?
No, sir.
Okay.
It's wrong.
Right. Again.
See, that's the problem.
I'm probably not expressing myself
Let's
correctly
let it talk,
here.
Folks. Let's let it
I'm
talk.
Probably not expressing myself correctly here. When it comes down to it, you and I may very well believe that it's going to violate the Constitution. Now, are you going to suffer some type of penalty of it because a court believes it goes one or the other? Of course you will. That's what I'm trying to say there, okay? I'm not saying that it's right. I'm not saying that it goes with the Constitution. I'm saying you may very well suffer some type of penalty for it because the court says it's okay with the Constitution, or it doesn't, or you'll be acquitted or whatever because the court says it doesn't meet constitutional muster. But again, a court will determine that whether you're going to have some type of penalty. It's not going to be me, okay? You guys agree with that, right?
No.
You don't agree that even though I say you're not going to...
We agree with that part.
You're yeah.
protecting from that.
Right. What I'm going to say is, though... Right. I guess I'm having a hard time getting my meaning across. I really am here. I really am. I'm having a hard time getting my meaning across.
Let's see if I can help you a little bit. They have no jurisdiction. It doesn't matter what the court says. They have no jurisdiction. That is plain English in
okay,
the Constitution.
Right. And you might very well agree with that, but of course you're going to have a court that says that they do. It might.
Well,
I'm not saying they're right, Russell. I'm saying the court will say that they do. Is that right? Otherwise, there's a lot of people in federal court, in federal prisons right now that shouldn't be there, right? Right. I don't disagree with that. The problem is, we can only do what we can do right here.
Well, this is. I see what you're saying. I actually agree with the sheriff to a point there. But here's the thing. This is what we're trying to do. We're trying to build a base to stop that from happening in the first place.
Right.
Because these agencies have to learn to conform to the rule of law.
And if I don't know that it's occurring or where it's occurring, where I can point, because you can suppose or what if something all to death. You really can. You can suppose it all to death. But when you actually have an incident or an instance, when you can say, this is what occurred, here's what occurred, and this is exactly what happened. You got something actually to base your opinion on. You got something that occurred.
Okay.
If I can have those things, a much stronger case of getting them to see it this way.
Okay. Well, I'll tell you what, folks. Are you willing to hang around for a few minutes and answer some questions individually?
Sure.
Thank you very much, Sheriff. Thank you, Sheriff. Now, you guys that want to talk to the sheriff, ask him your questions. He'll hang around for a few minutes and answer your questions. Please do. We need to let people go. But you can see we got our work cut out for us, I think. So, anyway. Okay, well, let's be dismissed. Thank you guys for your support.